Hey guys, Professor Bill, Comic Book University, and it's time for a podcast. All right, let's break right into this because I don't have all day for this. Anyway, Defenders. Defenders finally has a release date, the 18th of August. Looking forward to it. It's only going to be 8 episodes. Usually all these other individual characters, go figure, they've got 13 episodes each, right? And here we got only 8 episodes for 4 characters. Nope, sorry, make that 6 characters because the Daughters of the Dragon will be in this also. And also Night Nurse will be in there. So you're talking about 7 characters. Plus there's going to be like a main villain. And I really feel like they've only got time for one main villain. I mean, wow. How are you going to have all that in only 8 episodes? Honestly, I don't know. We'll have to see. We are not quite so sure how good it's going to be anymore, right? Because Iron Fist wasn't really that good. Sorry. It was good. It just wasn't up to par. That's the thing. You put Iron Fist by itself, and if it was the first Marvel movie that, or, you know, for Netflix that came out, oh, yeah, you'd watch this TV series, not a movie, and you go, oh, yeah, this was pretty good. Yeah, wow, hey. And then Daredevil come along, you'd be like, oh, my God, it was amazing. So, yeah, you start off with some really high bars. Okay, some really high bars. I don't know what to say. In the meantime, yeah, I don't know what they're going to do with the Defenders. If you maybe saw that little mini trailer, the teaser, it's really more of a teaser than anything else. Just all 4 of them, service elevator 2, all right, going up, like, you know, the levels to the bad guys. Looked pretty good. You know, Jessica Jones turns around and she takes out the camera. And everybody looks really tired. And it's funny, Danny Rand is wearing the mask now because, oh, I'm really, you know, everybody knows me, so I kind of have to wear a mask. I was happy with it. What do you call it? Anyway, so these guys going into battle, there was a timestamp up on the top. Go figure, that was an Easter egg. Brought you to the New York Bulletin page where it just gives you a whole bunch of little articles about Danny Rand and a whole bunch of the characters just talking about, you know, little tidbits and things like that. I like Easter eggs, man. I love Easter eggs. I haven't seen Easter eggs in movie trailers and things like that, like online stuff, since like The Grudge, you know, and The Matrix and stuff like that. That was really good viral marketing. Cloverfield was actually really amazing viral marketing also. And I think most people would consider the king of viral marketing to be the original Blair Witch Project. I had Book of Shadows stuck in my head, which was part 2. That just sucked. But yeah, the original one, not this remake that just came out that I didn't even see, so I can barely judge on it. Anyway, so Defenders coming out, and plus production just started recently within the past couple days for Jessica Jones season 2. Booyah, loving it. No real word on who the main bad guy is going to be. Guys, make sure you follow this news on at Real Professor Bill on Facebook. News updates every day, multiple times per day, all comic book news all the time. And I've talked about this on there, but you know, we don't know who the big bad is going to be on there, but there's certain speculations. And one of them seems to be circling mainly around Typhoid Mary. Now she would not be, I want to say she would not be, but from what we have in the comic books now, the knowledge that I have of this character, it's a bad guy for Daredevil. It's a Daredevil villain. She is not worthy of being the big bad there. So she'd have to be working for somebody else. Maybe we would have the Kingpin as the big bad for this one. That could be cool. I just want you to think about Jessica Jones, the big bad being Kingpin, all right? And then you got Typhoid Mary in there. If you don't know, real quick, explain in a minute. Typhoid Mary is a schizophrenic, actually what they used to call schizophrenic. In the comics, they called schizophrenic. Nowadays, we know it's just multiple personalities, which is technically very different from standard schizophrenia, although you could be a paranoid schizophrenic. Psych 101 for Comic Book University, guys, go. But she's got several different personalities, and each personality has a different psychic representative. You got one that just does standard telekinesis, one that will do pyrokinesis and start fires and things, as opposed to just moving things. She's moving the individual molecules to start a fire. All sorts of really cool stuff. And she's basically a ninja type character. So I should probably put my hair up because it's probably getting distracting for you guys. Anyway, what do you call it? So you got that. And there's already talk of Daredevil season 3 about to start any day. any day. They could technically use the same studio. I don't know why they wouldn't, but unless they just really wanted to rush it. But there's no reason to rush it whatsoever. So I'm thinking as soon as Jessica Jones is finished filming, boom, you're going to have Daredevil Season 3 start filming immediately. And then we're just going to wait on Luke Cage. And I don't think anybody's really waiting on Danny Rand unless they want to see them correct a lot of mistakes that they made. Namely, I want to see hugging to death of Show Lao. I want to see that origin where he hugs the dragon to death. Anyway, guys, now we're going to talk a little bit about Dune, all right? Eric Roth, that's his name, right? Yep, Eric Roth. He did The Curious Case of Benjamin Button. He did Forrest Gump. That's probably his most famous, most popular movie did. He also co-did like The Insider. That was Russell Crowe. I believe that was the cigarette one, the cigarette company, the lawsuit. Anyway, he's going to be writing the Dune movie. Now, this could work. It could. We've already got, it's already been written, Frank Herbert, right? Was this 1964, I think it was? It was the first sci-fi book written by an actual scientist. I mean, an actual full-blown booyah accredited. And he was mostly trying to write about the eco-cycle of a planet and actually seeing the entire biosphere of this planet change from a desert planet to a life-giving planet and all the havoc it would cause to life on that planet, namely the sandworms. The sandworms can't survive with water, one touch of water pretty much, and they die. It's poison to them, you know? So you got a planet with zero precipitation. Thank you. Everybody yelling at the screen right now, you idiot, just say rain. But, anyway, so yeah, it could work. Also, if you've ever heard the name Kevin J. Anderson, okay, if you have, then you're probably a pretty big Star Wars fan and you've read a couple of the EU novels, the extended universe novels, which are no longer canon in, Star Wars. Because booyah, man, that's what I'm talking about. He's written some really good stuff. It was Ari Salvatore who killed Chewbacca, by the way. Spoilers, go away. Vector Prime, but what do you call it? Kevin J. Anderson wrote a bunch of the not-so-controversial stuff. So no moons landing on Wookiees, to the best of my knowledge. I haven't read all of his books. He also did a bunch of X-Files books, so... I never really got into X-Files, even the TV show. I know, heresy, right? But it's actually currently a comic and I'm not even reviewing it because whatever. But the point is, he's going to be co-writing this, creative consultant. I don't know if it's just for the writing, although it certainly is qualifications, but it could be co-consultant for the entire creativity of the movie, the entire creative process. But for now, he is, while not co-writing, he is co-helping, all right, as a consultant for the script. So I'm looking forward to it, man. I'm looking forward to it. The rights were just gotten back in November. All right, it's not too long ago. So we're going to see what happens. This is my favorite, one of my favorite novels for, you know, period. This is easily my favorite science fiction, although a very close one besides that would be 1984. Orwell, man, just Orwell. You got to love it. But yeah, bang. Dune. Seriously looking forward to it. I did not like the David Lynch one. I saw the Jodorowsky's Dune, that ridiculously long 3 hours, 3.5 hour, whatever it was, documentary about how his version was going to be. I thought it would have been cool. I would not have liked the ending. I'm not going to spoil it, but there was something in the end where if that ending happened, you couldn't have had a part two. Which the reason why they didn't have a part two to the David Lynch movie, which sucked all on its own, like that's not the weirding way. Muad'Dib. Like, no, that's not the way it works. But that's not the weirding way. But the idea is that movie sucked. That's why there was no part two. It didn't do well. The soundtrack was probably the best part of the entire thing. But then again, the acting, all the actors, stellar cast. But the movie itself, the directing was actually good. Everything was good about it except the script, all right? Whoever wrote that and did all those changes to the movie, you suck. You suck and you suck. There's a special place in hell for you. That's all I'm saying. A little bit mean. I'm mostly playing, mostly. But I hope you have a hot day. That's all I'm saying. Okay, moving on. Moving on. I also like the, not moving on from the subject. I did, however, like the sci-fi rendering of Dune and Children of Dune, which also included Dune Messiah. The first of those three parts was actually Dune Messiah. And Dune Messiah was my favorite. All right. Obviously, it couldn't have had Dune Messiah without Dune, the original. And I did love Children of Dune. After that, Chapter Half, all that other stuff, God Emperor of Dune. No, didn't like it. Absolutely did not like it. But I loved the first three Dune novels, and they deserve to be movies. They absolutely deserve to be put in movie format. It's a damned crying shame that more people in the world don't know about the beauty, the excellence of Dune. Now, moving on. All right. Okay, guys. The last part that I really want to talk about here is David Gabriel. Now, he's the VP of sales for Marvel. Okay. Marvel Comics specifically is what we're talking about here. He did some kind of an article, and guys, everybody in the world, for the most part, is talking about this. All right. Like, I got friends who are private messaging me, people from Japan. Hey, and I got people still over in Saudi Arabia where I used to work. I got people just all over the place back in the States. All right. And the UK, whatever. Anyway, like I'm doing a roll call here. All these people sending me private messages on Facebook saying, Bill, what do you think about this? It's like, crap, I'm going to have to do a podcast about this. And it's hard. It's hard to do this because I know it's a social justice type of, you know, social justice warrior type of situation where nobody really wants to. So, okay, here's the deal. Let's just try and keep this on a level. Yes, it is kind of a diversity problem. The problem here is that he blamed it. David Gabriel, he blamed this on the fans. He says that fans don't want to see women in comics. Fans don't want to see diversity in comics. So it's the fans' fault. And that's in a nutshell. That's not what he said. This isn't a nutshell. Maybe it was presented wrong, but it was presented wrong enough that even Axel Alonso, one of the heads of the comics, editor-in-chief, he has to get on and start doing interviews in a 3-page-long article, all right, trying to do some kind of damage control. And they're going to need a lot more damage control than that. All right. This guy, he's a VP of sales. All right. Now I specialized in marketing for my business degree. All right. So you got business degree, specialized in marketing, and one tiny fraction of that. People say it's everything, but it's not even close to everything. Sales is one tiny fraction of marketing. So this is a very specialized field this guy's talking about. And for him to turn around and say something like that is partially ignorant, all right? Partially ignorant, because there is some truth to it. There's also a lot of fabrication to that, or just uneducated dumbness, whatever. The trick is, even if it were 100% true, you don't actually say that. You don't say it out loud to the audience. You don't turn around and say, I'm putting out superior quality stuff, and it's your fault that you don't like it. There's a lot to do with this. And hey, VP of sales, maybe the sales price of the Marvel Comics is our biggest issue. For me, it is. I review these comics. I don't get paid for my channel. I don't monetize. One day, eventually, I will, but right now, I don't. So literally, this is just my love of the comics that I'm going out and purchasing these comics and trying to find the cheapest way to do it. You know what I'm saying? And sometimes Comixology is cheaper. Sometimes the comic book store is cheaper. And it's seriously, it's like almost bankruptable. Not quite that close. But anyway, it's an analogy. But wow, the Marvel comics are way too expensive now. DC is doing a great job of trying to keep their prices down. For the longest time, remember when they were only $2.99? And a lot of them still are really cheap in that regard. They're very inexpensive and still the great quality that we've come to expect from DC. Marvel, they keep on jumping up their prices. Now, sometimes you got some people, you know, I say, oh man, Amazing Spider-Man number 25, it's $10. Yeah, but like it's a really big, you know, comic, and it's got a lot of stuff in it. It's got all these writers, but it's $10. I mean, you know, like what are you doing? What are you doing? You know what I'm saying? So yeah, sometimes, like, I didn't even purchase that. I did a review of it because I sat down at the comic book store and I read it. I'm allowed to. The guy let me. Anyway, like, I can't afford, all right, to keep on buying all these different comic books all the time. And it was a good comic. I would like to own it. And I'm probably going to kick myself later on for not actually owning it. In the meantime, whatever. You know what I'm saying? Because it's too expensive. That's the real problem that we have. And Marvel is putting out a lot of comics. Now, honestly, these are quality comics. They're really good stuff. But there's so much out there. Sometimes people are afraid to, you know, invest in something new. They don't know what it is. Maybe it's garbage. And they don't want to pay this money for the garbage. Now, maybe Marvel could do a better job in trying to advertise these comics. Maybe do, you know what, like you've got free comic book day and things like that. Maybe do like actual free comics. You know what I'm saying? I'm not talking, I know they already do, but like put out more of them. Old adage that I learned when I was a kid, all right? And it's one of my favorites. The idea that you got to spend money to make money. You know, that's what you got to do. I worked as an auto mechanic for a while, all right? And when I was working as an auto mechanic, you have to buy your own tools. So here's the deal. You see a job in the, you know, a job sheet in the box, and it's like, okay, let me go see what it is. And you go and you start looking. It's like, oil change. Cool. I have the tools to do that. Tire rotation, tire change. I have the tools to do that. They're the basic standard tools, and they usually have them lying around that anybody can do these. But if you're talking about something like, brakes and shocks, that's going to pay more commission for me to do this job. Here's the problem. I don't have the wrenches necessary to do the struts and the brakes and the struts and the, oh my God, what a crappy mechanic I am. Struts and shocks, thank you, redeemed, you know, to do this and to do brakes and things like that. I don't have the tools to do this. Well, guess what? You can't do the job then. So you just lost money, and that pays more. Those jobs pay more than tire rotations, you know, and oil changes. So, you know, maybe Marvel needs to buckle down and consider to put out a couple more free comics. You want to advertise the digital. Digital is so much easier to do it that way, you know. You make the comic, all right? You still got to pay all the people involved in the process, but then you put out the digital comic for free, all right? I know they're putting out, like, the first four pages for a lot of the comics for free. Sometimes that's not enough. Right, especially when you're talking about a brand new character, that's not enough. It's just not. All right, so it's a lot, and there are a lot of new characters coming out. Now, they're doing legacy characters, which I am a fan of this, because that's kind of what the Marvel has always been. I mean, when you look back at the Fantastic Four and Thor comics, all right, they, you know, Adam Strange, all right? Adam Strange. Sorry, it's DC. Adam Warlock, all right, which I just did. You've got his original stories in the Fantastic Four and in Thor right there alone, all right? Bang. So they're already bringing up new characters. Hey, here you go. So what's the problem with suddenly having somebody else play the role of Thor? It's happened before. You've had Eric Masterson has taken over the role of Thor. Beta Ray Bill almost took a Corbinite, for crying out loud, almost took over the role of Thor permanently, right? That was in the very beginning of Walt Simonson's run. I mean, like, we were terrified, but it turns out these were actually cool characters. So I don't have a problem that Thor is no longer Thor. He's now just Odin's son, the unworthy Thor. I like that. I thought it was a very cool new story, all right? I like the idea. Like, how many people are like, you know, oh, man, Captain America, he's not Captain America anymore because he lost, and this was like, you know, a year ago, 2 years ago, whatever. He's not Captain America anymore. Sam Wilson's Captain America now. Sam Wilson's actually pretty good at Captain America. And I mean, who's more deserving of the shield than Sam Wilson? I know, you're going to say Bucky. It's not true, to me at least. Bucky was with Captain America in the original Captain America comics, all right, before he came back in Strange Tales and all that stuff. Strange Tales. Tales of Suspense. Different one. Strange Tales was Doctor Strange and Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. But Nick Fury. Anyway, so yeah, boom. Over here in Tales of Suspense, like when Captain America finally came back, actually in the Avengers, and then came over to, and then had, and then the title turned over into Captain America with Black Panther in it and all that good stuff. Nah, man. Now, he's lost his super soldier serum so many times, it's insane. It's insane. So it's cool. He became an old man and all that stuff, and he couldn't be Captain America anymore. He lost that before. He lost that. He gave the shield over to Bucky. Bucky had to take the shield, right? Gave the shield to Bucky. Hawkeye was going to be Captain America for a little while. That probably wouldn't have worked out so well, but I was excited to see that he was possibly, you know, going to become Bucky, Captain America. I'm getting a little bit off topic here, but the idea is that we've seen this stuff in the comics before. And if you don't remember it, maybe you weren't there for it, which is fine. A new comics reader, welcome. Welcome to the fold, brother. Welcome, sister. Love y'all. But please calm down. All right? Just because you've seen Thor Odinson being Thor all this time doesn't mean he's always going to be Thor Odinson. Sometimes things change, all right? I loved Eric Masterson as Thor. I loved when he became Thunderstrike. We've done this in the comics so many times. It's kind of absurd. Remember when Captain America wasn't Captain America anymore because John Walker took over? And U.S. Agent, man, he hasn't gotten the recognition they deserve because they just don't know how to put him in a solo comic and keep him in a solo comic. But hey, Venom. Isn't Venom technically another Spider-Man? And the clones, you got all the clones also. And some of them are actually cool. Some of them are cool. But come on, man. Look, I remember when Dan Slott took over writing for Amazing Spider-Man, and I know he's very controversial. A lot of people hate him. Whatever. I actually like his. I don't think he likes me, but I do actually like his writing at the very least. All right, I love what he does. He makes Spider-Man the way that Spider-Man always was. All right, and in many ways that's not a good thing. In many ways it is. It kind of is. But when push comes to shove, I loved the Superior Spider-Man. I loved when Dr. Octopus took over the body of Spider-Man, of Peter Parker, and he went around doing his thing. I loved that. Fans were up in arms and things like that, but I was one of the fans who actually liked it. You know what I'm saying? At first, I was a little bit worried, like, oh no, this is too big of a change. It's too major of a change. All these conservative comic book fans, what's up with that, man? What about the progressive comic book fans like me? All right, give it a chance. If it doesn't work, obviously it's going to go back. But putting up, like, you know, arms over this stuff, like, it's too much, man. It's too much. Look, sometimes a form of racism could come into things, all right? Like the Donald Glover thing, all right? He said, you know, how come I can't be Spider-Man in a movie? Well, he did say, can I be Spider-Man? He didn't say, can I be Peter Parker? I don't know if he meant it or didn't mean the Peter Parker thing, but he specifically said Spider-Man. And I've mentioned this before, that he's a pretty good actor, all right? And I'm kind of hoping to see him as Miles Morales in the upcoming Spider-Man Homecoming movie. I would love to see that. Maybe not Miles. He's a little bit older now, so maybe he would be like Miles' father. I would be totally down with that. Totally down with that. But the idea is, I think that when you try and change something, people get upset. Any kind of a change, people get upset. But sometimes there does need to be that calm down factor. But when you're in charge of Marvel, you can't turn around and say, you need to calm down. You really can't when you represent Marvel like that. I don't represent Marvel. I don't work for them. They don't cut me a paycheck. You know what I'm saying? So when I say, chillax a little bit, it's very different than them saying it. You know, I think that was totally wrong that he went and did something like that. But I understand the idea that people are upset over so many legacy characters handing down their legacy, you know. The Miss Marvel Kamala Khan thing was actually done very well. Now, make no mistake, nobody's saying that there wasn't controversy there. I remember when it first happened. I was actually in Jeddah, Saudi Arabia, teaching the third grade at the time, all right? And you know, some Muslim guys around me from all sorts of different parts in the world, not just Saudis. I knew people from Somalia, people from Egypt, people from all over, you know what I'm saying? And I'm sitting there saying, you know, hey, man, there's actually going to be a Muslim character taking over the role of a very famous Marvel character. Okay, this girl named Miss Marvel, she's going to become Captain Marvel now, and she's going to take over the role. This Kamala girl, she's a Pakistani young Muslim girl from Jersey, like me, right? She's from Jersey. And, you know what I'm saying, like regular Americans or whatever weren't the only ones that were kind of upset over this. There were people upset over it, You know what I'm saying? Still had friends back in the States. You know, like, dude, what's up? They're throwing this stuff in our face. It's not really throwing it in your face if they put it there and say, hey, buy the comic or don't. It's still a choice thing. But the comic sold, and the comic sold really well, meaning that enough people were okay with it being thrown in their face. Miss Marvel is one of the most interesting comic book characters you could possibly ever read in the modern day. And if you don't agree, it might be a chance that you've never actually read the comic. Is that a bad thing? But, like, I don't like to talk about things that I don't know about. So, but there were still, Muslim people in Saudi Arabia who were like, that's not good. Like, why is it not good? Like, it's diversity. It's a good thing. Nah, they're just trying to make a buck off of this. Wow. Way to judge. Because you got somebody like G. Willow Wilson, who's actually writing the comic book. She's a Muslim. It's not just about making money off of that. Sana Aminat. I don't actually know her last name. I think it's Sana Aminat. If you look her up on YouTube, you can see that she actually did a TED Talk on this. She's one of the creators, all right? And I think that she was one of the publishers or one of the editors. I think that she was one of the editors on the team for the creation of the comic. But she was a part of the creation process for this comic. And she did a TED Talk about, you know, the creation of the character and all sorts of different things with it. And she will also talk about the kickback, all right, that happened, the backlash that happened from trying to introduce this character. So anybody who did, because I see a lot of people today saying, oh, she was welcome with open arms. No, she absolutely was not, okay? And, yeah, you can go and check this stuff out. But she had kickback from both sides, all right, from both sides, from Muslims and from non-Muslims. So the idea this character broke through was an amazing thing. Now, the problem is Marvel starts kicking in a couple other characters, too. And by a couple, I mean a lot. All right. Amadeus Cho was with us for a while. When he became the Hulk, you'd think it was a good thing. But a lot of people, oh, I want my Bruce Banner back. Okay, cool. You know, Jane Foster, you know, or just a female Thor first, you know, the first 10 issues, I think it was, we didn't know it was Jane Foster. So that's almost a year of not knowing. And, you know, just, oh, I don't want Thor girl. Thor girl is a different character. This is Thor. It's female Thor. It's not actually her name, but okay, whatever. And I found the comics to be very, to this very day, it's one of the most intriguing comics, all right, that I'm reading. It's kind of hard to do reviews on them, just too much. But I love the Thor comics. How can you not? Miles Morales as Spider-Man. He's the most powerful Spider-Man. He's probably the most interesting Spider-Man. I know. Kick me in the teeth later. I like Miles Morales Spider-Man a lot. A whole lot. I still like Superior Spider-Man better. Sue me. So it is what it is. But I mean, it's hard to introduce new characters. It's very hard to introduce new characters. I'm going to give you an example. Mosaic. If you know who Mosaic is and you're watching this podcast, you probably, possibly know Mosaic because of my reviews of Mosaic. They're already up to issue 6. Issue 7 should be coming out pretty soon. He was a little bit, and he was only a little bit in the AVX Wars. AVX. Why did I do it? It's not Avengers versus X-Men. The X-Men versus Inhumans. Inhumans versus X-Men thing. Anyway, the X-Men versus Avengers. He was in that, and it was a very small role, but extremely significant what he did. And man, like, people are like, who is this guy? Who is this guy? Bill, who is this guy? Don't you actually watch my reviews? He's a pretty cool character. He's a new Inhuman character. He's very cool. But he didn't take on a legacy character's name. Therefore, you don't know who he is. These other guys, like Miles Morales, you know who that is. All right, you already knew who Jane Foster was, but like all these other, Kamala Khan, that's why you know who she is, all right? Amadeus Cho, maybe you weren't following the Hulk comics and you didn't know who he was. Who's more worthy of being him? Sam Wilson, if you didn't read the comic book, you know, like, these are characters who know these characters. Look, between Bucky and Sam Wilson, they're both the most worthy to take up the mantle. If anybody else were worthy of taking up the mantle of Captain America, it would probably be Rick Jones. Why? Because all these characters had something to do with Captain America in the comics. All of these characters, for the most part, are these legacy characters are who they are. The new Vision, Viv, all right, is the daughter, synthesoid daughter of the Vision, right? all these characters. Young Cyclops is Cyclops from a different past timeline. It's weird, but they're here for a reason. They're actually going to do the Generations comic, talking about the legacy characters and the prestige characters, the new characters coming up, you know? I mean, it's something they kind of got to do, you know what I'm saying? To promote these characters as good, as actually decent, because how else are you going to learn about these characters? Nobody wants to go out and buy Mosaic because it's a completely new character. They don't know who he is. Whatever, man. Whatever. So what are you going to do? The only other way to bring these characters up is to bring back sidekicks. Do you really want more sidekicks? I mean, it was good way back in the day when Robin, the very first sidekick, Dick Grayson, right? And after that, everybody had a comic book. The Human Torch had a comic book sidekick. All right, Toro. What? Toro sucked. You didn't need to see two flammable characters running around. I mean, what honestly are you going to do anymore? You know, like, you got all these Flash characters who just come out of nowhere. All of them have the ability to run really fast. That's very interesting. It's very interesting. But I mean, when push comes to shove, isn't it lucky that Dick Grayson, all right, happened to have his family killed at Haley Circus while it was in Gotham City? Because if it had happened over in Central City, all right, hey, the Flash could have come and solved that crime and figured everything out, but we wouldn't have had a Robin. We wouldn't have Dick Grayson being anything. We would never have a Nightwing. Because what's the Flash going to do? Show up and be like, okay, Dick, you just got to run a little bit faster to be my sidekick. No way. You have to run a whole lot faster. You got no Speed Force. What's he going to do? What's he going to do? You know, like, he'd be nothing if he was in Central City. What if he were over in Coast City? What would he be? Okay, yeah, nowadays we know because of Sinestro two years ago, that he can make a new ring out of a ring he's already got. And he's just got to keep concentrating on it in order to keep it fresh so that Sinestro can give it to Hal Jordan when he got booted from the Green Lanterns. Beautiful story, man. Really good job on that one. But like, what's he going to do? Like, go out and get, like, a little mini ring at the time? It's like, this is a junior version of the ring. Mine lasts for 24 hours. Yours will last for 24 minutes. So keep saying that oath, buddy. Like, what's he going to do? You know? So to constantly have all these very convenient sidekicks that can do exactly what the other ones do. Hey, Aqualad, you just happen to have water powers like me, you know? And Toro, you happen to have fire powers just like me. Very convenient. But not very realistic. And nobody likes sidekicks anymore. Nobody likes sidekicks anymore. So what else are you going to do? You know? So Marvel has to understand that they already shoved way too many characters at us at one time. We don't have enough money to buy all these new characters, especially with the exorbitant prices of their comics. They kind of have to take it down a notch. Okay, they have to take it down a notch because they're just hitting us way too fast, way too often. Comic book fans, actual comic book fans, are for the most part are not racist. All right, they've never come out to me as racists. Doesn't mean they don't exist. I'm just saying, for the most part, I'm just not seeing it. You know what I'm saying? I actually just had a very interesting conversation with someone on YouTube because someone was saying, oh, you know, the Mockingbird. They brought up several comics and one of them was Mockingbird. I was like, you know, there was a lot of feminism backlash against Chelsea Kane. She actually wound up going off of Twitter because she put on the cover of her, or she didn't put it on, but, you know, somebody put on the cover of her magazine, her comic, issue number 8 of Mockingbird, asked me about my feminist agenda, which I thought was beautiful. I thought it was great. You know, I was reading the comic book. I understood it completely, you know what I'm saying? And I was totally into it. Bang! Let's check out this comic. And people got upset over it. If you were reading the comic, you knew what the comic was all about the whole entire time. If you were not reading the comic book, that means that you are a comic book fan in some way, shape, or form or another, and you had some kind of a problem with seeing the cover. You clearly were not reading the comic. You were not interested in the comic in the first place, so you probably didn't have any place talking in the first place. May sound rude. Deal with it. But I think that the biggest problem is people who are not comic book fans at all. Maybe they're not even superhero fans. They got a hold of this, and they use this for their own agenda. And they went and they started trolling Chelsea Kane for this. That's kind of the way that I'm looking at it because I just don't see comic book. I mean, when you really think about it, comic book fans, man, we got beaten up in high school, right? Like we had to learn how to fight in high school or defend ourselves or run really fast or find bigger friends, you know what I'm saying, who were maybe also into comic books. I was one of those bigger friends, just saying. But the idea, I still got picked up to, I didn't go around and start reading comic books in open. I absolutely did not. I never sat and read a comic book in the open, all right, in school. I wouldn't do that because it kills your social reputation. Today may be different with all the movies out. The movies back then, when I was a kid, they sucked, the comic book movies. Just go back and look at the 1990 version of Captain America. They sucked, all right? But the point that I'm making here is we got bullied all the time. We were social outcasts forever. So the idea of picking on someone else, that just doesn't sound like a real comic book fan to me. It doesn't make sense to me. So take it for what it is. That's the way that I'm viewing this. And I'm an older comic book fan. You know what I'm saying? Today, I believe it's a lot more open. People are wearing comic book t-shirts and things like that. I wear comic book t-shirts all the time right now. You know what I'm saying? I remember a friend in South America who saw me wearing this, my I Am Groot. He looked and was like, dude, that's a cool shirt. I was like, yeah, Guardians of the Galaxy. He's like, what are you talking about? I was like, I Am Groot from Guardians of the Galaxy. He's like, oh, yeah, in Afrikaans, Groot means great. So I Am Groot means I am great. Ist Groot. So, like, wow, man. Way to mess with your Dutch and the Afrikaans, right? That was cool, but, like, he's not a comic book fan, so he didn't know what this even was, you know? Today, the kids, everybody knows, if you're in high school right now, everybody knows who Groot is. You know what I'm saying? So, I see comic book shirts in school today. I couldn't wear a comic book shirt in school when I was a kid, when I was growing up. I'm telling you. And I wasn't even one of the weaker little ones. I'm 6'5 now. You know what I'm saying? I wasn't much shorter when I was in high school. I was always tall. I was always pretty big. I knew all the wrestlers and the weightlifters, all right? I was in track and field, and everybody knew I was a martial artist. You know what I'm saying? I was one of the, you know, I wasn't one of the cool kids, but I wasn't one of the, you know, dorky, nerdy kids. But I would hang out with the dorky, nerdy kids outside of school. You know what I'm saying? Sorry. I'm sorry. I wasn't brave enough to be a social outcast. I just wasn't. All right. I was weak. Sorry. But think about that, man. Like, we couldn't do that. I could not wear a Captain America t-shirt or even a Spider-Man t-shirt to school. Because right away, I know, everybody would be like, you kid, were you wearing your underoos? If you don't know what underoos is, then you couldn't possibly understand the social disparity of going to school wearing freaking, oh my God. Yeah, when Tony Stark called Spider-Man underoos in Captain America Civil War, yeah, I had underoos when I was really little kid. Do they make underoos for adults now? Because I would buy them now. Anyway. That's my rant on Mr. Gabriel, VP of sales, who should probably consider apologizing and resigning, because I think that that's just really bad press for, and if this video gets back to you and you see this and you're saying that I'm an idiot, I'm not the idiot who went online or who went anywhere and talked to a media outlet and said, and try to blame my buyers, all right, the people I'm trying to sell to, and trying to tell them that they're wrong. All right, just whether it's true or not, man, it's not smart. It's not smart. So take it for what it is. Ignore it. I don't really care. I don't get paid for this anyway, man. So anyway, guys, I'm going to call that a wrap. I hope you enjoy the podcast. Guys, don't forget to check me out on SoundCloud, all right? You just hear me there or see me here on YouTube. And looking forward to expanding, getting a little bit bigger, maybe seeing what's going on with that. And don't forget to check me out on Facebook at Real Professor Bill. Good stuff, news every day. You can also check me out, Comic Book University Group on Facebook. I post all my videos there. All right. And check me out on Twitter also, Comic Book Uni, at Comic Book Uni. You can check me out there. And yeah, anyway, guys, love, peace, hair grease, all that good stuff. Professor Bill, Comic Book University, and this class is dismissed.